Hello and welcome to the Be Glad movement. My name's Pollyanna and I'm on a mission to bring you as many stories as possible of good coming out of bad and reasons to be glad. And I'm really excited today because I'm joined by a brand new friend who reached out via the powers of social media, Instagram to be precise. I'm joined by Diesel Donlow, who I don't actually know much about yet, if I'm honest. So this is going to be real cool. Interview, just learning about each other as we go along. I grasp that Diesel is an actor, he's played basketball, and he's an entrepreneur, he's got his own clothing line, loads of cool things. So it's going to be a fun interview. And without further ado, me waffling on, I'm going to say, Hey Diesel, how are you this morning?
Good morning, how are you doing? Thank you for having me here today.
You are welcome. Thank you for reaching out and asking to come on the show, because it's exciting when people find me, because I'm only a small fry, you know. I'm really pleased that you're here. I'm going to just let you dive right in and tell us what it was like growing up in Ohio and where your life journey has taken you.
I grew up in Youngstown, Ohio, which is a city in between Cleveland, Ohio and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So we really close to the Pennsylvania border. Have some family that's, you know, in Pennsylvania. So we just always been close to Pennsylvania and, you know, living near the, they call it the Steel Valley area. Okay. It was a lot of steel mills here growing up. Before my time, my grandfathers and, you know, people before me worked through the steel mills. And they had a lot of steel mills in this area, like, you know, long ago, you know, with Andrew Carnegie, you know, all the way down to, you know, 1980s. So we work really hard around here, and you know, it's like a town like where people work really hard. Like, they're all about working hard and providing for their families. I'm sure it's like that everywhere, but you know, in this area is really known for that, working really hard and, you know, working like each day is your last. So that's where I developed that work ethic that I have, is from my city and my mom. She worked so hard. It was she had a single parent home. You know, my dad had his own situation where he had to take care of his other family, which wasn't a problem. You know, just how life is. So my mom was taught me a lot of taught me a lot of my skills. It taught me a lot of, like, how to, you know, do the things I do. And she taught me real early that how to be an adult.
Right.
So I had to learn real early, like, how to wash clothes, how to do dishes, how to take the trash out, how to do the lawn. You know, because I was the only guy in the house. I was raised with three other women and me. So
that's why
I love women. I love being around women, because my mom is a woman. So, and I was raised with a house full of women. So that's why I connect with you guys probably a lot, because my mom and my sisters were, they were in trouble. So
tell me, are your sisters older or younger?
I have another sister on my dad's side. But my mom has two daughters, and my sisters are older. One lives in Washington, D.C., and the other one lives, like, near here where I'm from. So my mom just, like, taught me, and my sisters taught me, like, a lot. That's what I learned from. So they taught me how to drive, you know, everything that I do. They taught me how to drive. So growing up, I grew up in a single-parent home. Like I said, my mom worked extremely hard to provide for me and my sisters. And I played basketball to, you know, that was my I guess what you say, my sport to get to the next level of my life. I traveled all around the world playing basketball. I was one of the top players in the United States at one point in my life. You know, then I went to one of the best high schools in the area. We moved to a town called Poland, Ohio, which is a suburb of Youngstown. And I go out there in like sixth grade, and I earned my way. I played varsity as a freshman. I'm not sure if that's what they call it over there when you get in high school. Is it like different teams? Let's see. I think it's club levels over there. It's a whole different system over there where you're from.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm not the biggest. I'm the worst person to ask about sports anyway, but I'm not really sure how basketball works over here, because it's not such a big game for us. Oh, I'm going to have people telling me, actually, there is a big basketball thing going on, you just don't know about it. But so you were at I think we would call uni or high school. So We go from primary school to sort of school to maybe college, uni, and then, so would you have been at university doing prep?
It was still high school level here. What we do is we go to middle school, which is 7th and 8th grade, and then we go to high school, that's 9th through 12th. And then after 12th grade, we go to a university and play, or you can go professionally, depending, like, you know, how good you are or not. So, but my mom moved us out here to get better education. Our city of Youngstown, they have improved a lot since then, but my mom didn't want me to grow up in that environment. Where we lived at was a lot of high crime.
Okay.
It was crime. So we our house got broken into one time, but we still had some issues, you know, where it was just, it wasn't a safe area anymore. So my mom said, hey, we got to pack our bags up and move.
So,
right. I get to Poland and had a great coach named Ken Grisdale. One of the best coaches I ever had. You know, he taught me a lot of discipline and structure. And also, I had some great teammates their names are Nico Vitimus, Luke Wallet. Those two guys pushed me a lot. I'm really grateful that I had two teammates. And Nico, in particular, we worked out a lot. You know, we practiced a lot together. He has his own restaurant in Pennsylvania. We used to go there a lot and eat. His dad used to take us there. And during the summers and springs, we would travel with an AAU team. And we'll go around the world and play against the best players in the world. So that got me a lot better. And, you know, eventually led me to college.
Cool. Very cool. And college is the equivalent of our university, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. They call it university.
Uh-huh. And so, just to clarify, the basketball, did you kind of get in on a sports scholarship kind of thing? Or?
Well, I had a few offers. See how it works in over here is that it's different levels and tiers of how things work in scholarships. So I eventually declined. I had an offer to St. Thomas University. It was a Division II school out in Florida, and I didn't want to go there. I didn't want to go that far away at the time. So I took a later offer, and I went to Westminster College and played there for a year and a half, 2 years, and then my career kind of went. You know, it was over.
Right. Okay. So tell me, like, what it was like growing up. I mean, you said about your sisters and, you know, that it could have gone two ways. You obviously had the nurturing family environment rather than the henpecked environment of being the youngest. So what did you do after college? What happened then?
So after college, after my years of playing basketball, I transferred to like 6 different colleges, by the way, or university, just because I wanted to make sure my education, if I was not going to be in playing basketball, I want to go to a school that it was just a good fit for me. So I eventually went to a school called Hiram College, and I went to Hiram, and then I graduated with my degree in business management with a focus with marketing. And I had a minor in entrepreneurship, and my last year there, I studied abroad in Chile, which broadened my horizons because I still have friends down in Chile now that I still connect with. And it was just crazy because when I went to Chile, I guess I got, God gave me a sign to my next phase of life. If I don't go to Chile, I don't think I become what I was, you know, what I am now. So when I was down there, I was studying and I just kept asking, you know, hey, man, God, what do I guess I would say like that. What? Hey, God, what do you want me to do? I was like, I don't know what to do next, you know? And I was just walking and just paying gratitude as well. I didn't know I was doing gratitude then, but I was just thankful that I was there because I kept seeing, like, acting stuff, you know, like acting, like billboards and the Transformers came out, you know, all these things came out. I was like, man, I could see myself being on set, you know, acting and, you know, inspiring people that way. And at the same time, I was getting my master's degree too when I was done. So I applied for my master's degree and I got accepted to a university called California University of Pennsylvania. And there I did my exercise science as well as pursue my acting. So as soon as I got home from abroad, I was on set like, you know, 3 weeks later.
Cool.
My first set was a show called Banshee. It's no longer filming. You know, I go on set and the role, I was just a background player or extra. And I met this young lady on set. She taught me so much. She was like, hey man, I know you're gonna do this full time. You know, God told me to come over here to talk to you and give you more information. So she gave me more information on how to, you know, pursue, you know, more, you know, opportunities. And so it just led me from there to, you know, being on, you know, big shows in the U.S., you know, Chicago PD, Empire, Chicago Med, Chicago Fire, Chicago Justice, Outsiders, oh my God, Billions, so many different movies and shows that that I did. And it led me to meeting, you know, many people. So a lot of people always ask me, how did I get verified on Instagram? I'm like, you got to do your history check. Well, yeah. Because I went through so many different things. Like it was, I've been on different shows and different crime shows. I always play a criminal or I play a cop. So it's like, you know, it's just God really blessed me and gave me the opportunities to inspire other people through my gifts. So,
do you know what? I just want to rewind a minute because I think you said something really important earlier about swapping and changing schools and trying to find the right school for you. Because there are so many people that wouldn't be brave enough to do that. And you kind of, I mean, I know I was the first on my mum's side of the family to go to university. And she was really cool about it. She was like, because I'm a home bird, and she was sort of like, just go. And if you don't like it, you can always come home. And then when I got there, I was like, there's so many kids out there that would kill to have a place at university. I'm actually here. I've got to make the most of it. And there were times when I considered quitting, but I saw it through. But I think, you know, taking the time to actually be brave and saying, no, this isn't right for me. I'm going to try something else. No, this isn't right. I'm going to try something else. Is really important because you can get stuck in a rut and you can get get yourself sailing down the wrong path for you. And so I just want to say I think that was brave to keep swapping and changing, and it clearly led you on this other path of finding yourself in Chile and finding this lady that encouraged you as well. So that's very cool.
Right. If I don't go to different schools, I wouldn't be here. You know, I mean, I don't know if I'd be here because, you know, I was on someone else's journey instead of my own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So important. And so you've been on all these shows, but are you actually still, I almost want to rewind again because I want to go back to the basketball and say, because I mean, I've already admitted that I'm not a sportswoman. But is the basketball teams, was there a particular team that maybe someone in the UK would recognize, or?
They might not recognize the players. They might recognize the university.
Okay.
Because wow. I had a teammate that was from the UK, and he came to ours. You know, his name was Anthony Humes.
Okay. Cool.
And he's from the UK. And so he came to our school. So I don't know, like, if someone's listening, but my school was Westminster College, and Anthony Humes was one of the players, but he's from the UK. So if that helped recognize, you know, that's the only way I would think that I could recognize. And I don't even know how I thought about his name. It was just, as soon as you said UK, I remembered he was from there.
I wonder if he's still over with you or whether he's back in the UK now, what he's up to now.
Last that I heard that he was back over there, which you know, over in UK.
Okay, cool. And then there's all this acting that you've done, but now you're, as I understand it, you're more concentrating your efforts on your entrepreneurship and the clothing brand, and I think you even do music as well, right? So
yeah.
Anyway, I'm gonna let you get back into your story and tell us what happened.
Well, I moved to Chicago after that year. So this is 2015. 2016, I moved to Chicago, and over here in the U.S., I think it's like that overseas too. That when you get into the acting, it's levels to the, you know, how hard, how high you can get, I guess. It's just, it's an acting union called SAG-AFTRA union. I'm not sure if you heard it. It's a, people that act over there, they would know. But it's like a union that's, it's a prestigious union that actors get in once you get a certain amount of, you know, hours or a certain amount of, you know, the right shows or the right situation or the right project you get on, you know, they bump you up to a principal role or, you know, all that happened. So when I moved to Chicago in 2016, pursuing that goal that I have, all like the whole year going up to it, I heard about how hard it was to become, you know, SAG from where I lived at, Youngstown, which wasn't a lot of films going on around this area at all. I had to go to Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh's about, you know, about 45 minutes away to an hour. And even going there, the opportunities were still not limited. You know, God, like I said, God always makes a way. But I'm saying the opportunities at the time was limited to going to the next level. So what I had to do was, I was like, man, I got to go to Chicago. And I got to pursue outside, you know, areas because I have to go where the opportunities is. So I eventually go to Chicago and I work on the show Empire. And every day I'm on set. And I'm like, hey, man, I gotta get to this next level. So I see the stunt coordinator, you know, come by every day. And I tell him every time I see him, I'm like, I'm ready to go. And I'm doing this for 3 months, right. You know, 3 months straight. I've seen him like, you know, a couple times a week. I'm like, hey, I'm ready for my opportunity. And he eventually gave me the opportunity. And he said, he just gave me the opportunity because he's like, man, all right, I'm gonna give you a chance. I'm tired of you basically hounding me. I had to do that though, because if I don't do that, you know, it just be not worth it, you know, not going up there and not pursuing it. But the reason I got to Chicago was my youth pastor. He was from Youngstown. Well, he's not from Youngstown, but my church that I used to go to, he used to be here, and then he moved away. But he moved back there. He moved to Chicago because that's where he's from. So he said I could move in with him. You know, so I moved in with my pastor, Pastor Kareem. Man, if it wasn't for him, he allowed me to pursue, you know, my goals and my dreams. It helps see people like that on the journey. Always, you got to have someone there on the journey that helps like that, because, you know, I wouldn't be where I am today without that sacrifice by him. And I took people with me too, man. I got a lot of people on set just because I wanted them to see like life is bigger than, you know, than where their current state of mind was. So I get to Chicago and I get my first principal role, or first performer role. And I was grateful for that because it led me to Chicago PD and me doing stunts for LaRoyce. He's the main actor on Chicago PD. I did stunts for him for 2 seasons. And I was blessed that Tom Lowell gave me an opportunity to become part of the show. And I went from there to more of using my gifts. Now I'm going into the entrepreneur stuff. My clothing line, I already formed that 2 years ago. So it was just getting it to keep it going, you know, keep fueling it. And my clothing line, I really put more emphasis on it after, you know, like 2017, 2018. I was really focused on creating my clothing line. And I'm in my office now, right now, which has all my stuff that to make clothes. So really just all that stuff, just like it kept like leading me on to something new, you know, each thing.
Wow, awesome. That's so cool. And that pastor, I've got to mention him again, because that's so cool that he offered you somewhere to live while you were pursuing your acting career. So do you do any acting now, or have you sort of put that to one side now and it's more about the clothing brand?
I have this like inner like battle with this all the time. I miss acting because that's like more my that's my passion. The clothing is more, they're all my passions, but I don't want to take away from one another. But I really want to get back to it to a high level. And I want to finish some goals that I have. And I'm not done yet with that one. So I think I want to continue to, I have some goals that I want to win an Emmy and I want to win an Oscar. You know, I have some goals that I want to do. And I have one story I forgot to mention with you. Mm-hmm. I met Denzel Washington on set.
And
I know you know who Denzel is, correct?
Yeah.
I know you know who he is. Okay. I met him the next year after I told you, I met him the following year when I started pursuing it. And I was on set with him, and me and him talking for in a small room for about, 10 minutes. And he was just proud that I continued my education. And I want people to know that Denzel Washington is about education. And I'm glad that he said that to me. He was like, man, you're smart. He said, you're getting a degree and you're pursuing this at the same time. What better way can you live? Basically what he was saying. And I gave him some of my clothes as well. So you see how it all ties in together. Uh-huh. And he was like, oh, okay. He's like, okay. All right. I can do his voice, but I won't do it right now. But he just said, that he was going to wear it on one of the shows. He never wore it yet. When I see him, I'm going to tell him, like, hey, you still never wore the hoodie on the show yet. He said he was going to wear it on Jay Leno. That was years ago. But so, like I said, like, if I don't meet these beautiful people, like, how can I inspire people on your podcast? Like, if I don't go through this walk. Mm-hmm. And so I have this battle right now. Do I want to act more? Do I, I love my office and I love what I created here. So right now that I'm thinking that acting is what it is. I'm getting back to it. So,
yeah. We peak and trough our interests, don't they? You kind of get into one thing and then because we're all multifaceted. We all wear different caps for different occasions. And I think, our hearts sort of are torn constantly with me personally, being a mum and wanting to pursue a career and then having personal passion projects like the Be Glad movement. And you kind of think, am I spending my time? You enjoy all of it, but you're like, should I be putting more of my time here or should I be putting more of my time there? And sometimes it's kind of good to go, it's almost good to get lost to then remember what the correct direction is, so maybe it's just that you need to concentrate on the clothing line now, or you have been, and now, okay, I'm coming to the end of this feeling of wanting to get my teeth into that and I need to get my teeth into something else just to keep life varied and interesting.
Right. How did you ask a question? How did you start this podcast? Like, where were you at in your life?
Okay. So, my son was a year old, and it's sort of a tragic story, really. So, if I rewind backwards, I had the idea for the podcast, and life got in the way, and I didn't do it. Well, the project, I should say, because I hadn't any idea that it was going to turn into a podcast at that point in time. But when I was recording the interviews and putting it on YouTube, most people were saying, oh, you really should do a podcast. But I was like, oh, I can't learn how to do that as well, because I was like learning Twitter and Instagram and Facebook and stuff like that. So I was like, I can't add something else to the mix. But what happened was I had the idea. So for those who don't already know the story, my mum named me Pollyanna after the book and film Pollyanna, where the little girl plays the glad game. So she's always looking for positives in negatives. And when I was growing up, if ever anything went wrong in my life, my mum would say to me, now come on, Polly, play the glad game. And I'd have to list off any positives that I could see in that negative, but also everything that I was grateful for or lucky to have in my life, just to sort of like... Not, she didn't do it just to deny me the sadness or the pain that I was going through from the disappointing situation, because I do think it's really important that you process those feelings. She kind of did it to give me that firm bedrock of, okay, so I haven't had what I want, but I've still got everything I need beneath me. So, and it kind of just gave me that bedrock to sort of reach again, try again, okay, you didn't get what you want this time, but you can still try again, that kind of thing. Right. So anyway, sorry, I'm going off on a bit of a tangent. So that was kind of like the history of my name. And then I follow this life coach who I love, called Marie Forleo. I don't know if you've ever come across her, because she's also American. And she, in her videos, she always says at the end, that the world needs that special something that only you have. And I spent ages pondering that. I was thinking, what have I got that other people don't have? What, who am I to even want to inspire other people or help other people? And I already knew I wanted to be a coach at that point in time, but I wasn't sure, how, what other thing that I had that I could offer the world. And then, you know, it sort of dawned on me, well, I'm Pollyanna. I've got the Be Glad game that my mum taught me. And it's actually been a really great strategy for living, a strategy for life. You know, I use it all the time. If things don't turn out, I'm always like, okay, well, I haven't got that, but I have got all of this, you know.
Right.
And this is what I need. You know, this is what I need to share with the world. Because loads of people have seen the Pollyanna film, you know, the Disney film. Loads of people have seen it, but I don't know how many people actually took away the core message, which is the playing the glad game and looking for positives in negatives. And I know over in the States that Pollyanna is actually a bit of a derogatory term, because sometimes if you call someone a Pollyanna, it means that they're maybe a bit naive or overly optimistic, whereas... Right. For me, I just think Pollyanna was, she never sort of pretended like the bad things weren't happening. She just sort of was like, okay, well, that's that, but let's look for something else that we can concentrate rather than dwelling on the negative and going into a downward spiral. So I just think that's quite a nifty trick, really, to, okay, say, yeah, this is bad, but let's look for the good things instead. Let's not just dwell on that. So I don't think she was naive or overly optimistic. I think she just chose to look on the sunny side of things. Anyway, so that idea came to me, I think, back in 2015. And then my life got in the way. I got married. I moved house a couple of times. I got a dog, had a baby. My son's now 3.5. But when he turned one, very sadly, I actually lost two friends to cancer, Buffy and Sharon, and they were sort of my age group. And I just thought, you know, crikey, how would I feel if I had got the news that they had got, that, you know, you're going to die imminently? What would I really regret not having done? And I thought, I really need to do this project. I need to collect the stories and help people that are going through a tough time, not say, oh, look, other people have had such a bad time, a worse time than you, not saying that. It's more of, look, other people have been through hard times and they've managed to turn that adversity to their advantage. And although you're in the thick of it and you may not feel it now, then there will more than likely come a day where you'll be able to grow stronger and use what you're going through to either help yourself or help someone else, you know. So don't think you're just suffering in vain. So that was kind of the point of the project. And then I basically just sort of set myself some SMART goals. I'm going to collect 100 stories by the end of the year and raise money for charity. We've got a charity over here in the UK called The Samaritans, which you can telephone and talk to people. I'm actually a listening volunteer myself, so I really believe in the work that they do. So if you're going through a really tough time, you can ring them and just talk through your thoughts and feelings, and it helps you get them straight in your head. That's sort of how the project properly started. So the idea came to me a while ago, and then in 2018 was that year where I collected the 100 stories. And then going back to what you were saying, what we were saying earlier about doing a bit of this and then doing a bit of that, because towards the end of 2018 it really consumed me, like getting that 100 story so that I'd finish the project. I kind of felt a little bit lost at the beginning of 2019, and I very much went down the coaching side of things. Right, I need to get the coaching business up and running better, because I had neglected it a bit. I think I lost my way a bit, because that all felt very much something that I needed to do, business, money, and it was more about the money and consumer, although I was helping people and I like helping people, and, you know, I come away from a coaching call on a high. I think I missed this project, which is why I decided to launch the podcast version of it as well. So sorry, I feel like I've taken over your
interview. No. I wanted to know because I'm on your show. I wanted to know how did it start. You know, I want to know because I'm curious because I wouldn't be on the show without you going through all those. So it's very important for me to know how it all happened. I'm very like intrigued by it.
Yeah. So that's kind of my story, and it feels like I don't really know which way it's going to go, whether anything will come of it. And I did speak to some people at the end of last year. They were like, oh, you know, it could be a book, like the, I don't know if you've ever come across the Chicken Soup for the Soul type series, that there could be that kind of element to it. I just don't know, but there's something that is pulling me back to this project, I guess, because it's my namesake as well, the whole Pollyanna element. And I enjoy talking to cool people, you know, and I love the fact that you reached out and, you know, you don't know me from Adam. You really just heard my story. You're like, oh, that's a cool idea.
Because I saw it, I was like, oh, I got to reach out. I got to get on here. Because like, I like helping people get it out. I like what my brand is about. You know, also my brand is I love collaborating. I love networking and I love marketing with different individuals or companies. So when I saw yours, I'm like, oh, okay, I think I can help her get her movement out there so people can see, hey, man, there's more people out there that's about gratitude, about positivity, about love, passion, whatever, the stuff that you're about. I wanted to share that to my community and my people that that don't understand, like, other people's doing this too, not just me.
Yeah, thank you. You
know, I wanted to help you, so.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And actually, when you're talking about gratitude, I think sometimes people have a misconception about gratitude, and they think that it's about staying stuck. It's about saying, I've got everything I need. This is it. I'm okay. I shouldn't want any more. But I think really gratitude is about saying, okay, I'm good. I'm in a strong position. I've got everything I need. And therefore, I can reach for more, you know. So remembering what you've got is so powerful when you're reaching for other stuff, because I think a lot of people concentrate too much on what they haven't got rather than what they have got. And that's when the mental health issues kick in, and the feeling disappointed and that kind of stuff can drag you down. So gratitude, you know, it kind of became a bit of a buzz thing and keeping a gratitude journal, but actually it's so powerful to really sort of take stock of what you've got and be grateful, you know.
That's true. Because I look around my office, I'm like, okay, sometimes I have to look at myself like, man, we got a lot here. I didn't know I didn't realize, sometimes you got to realize, you know, that you have a lot more than you think you do, you know. And sometimes I have to make sure I'm appreciative of what I have, because sometimes, I mean, I want more. I want the fan, you know, sometimes you want the nicer things. I'm not going to lie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm human. Come on. But I'm just saying, like, I had to look around and say, okay, I do have nice things. Mm. And once I said that, you know, then nice things came to me later.
Yeah. I think as well, you know, it can help to think about the people that would take off their left arm to have the things that we've got. You know, there's so many people that aren't as privileged as we are, and we forget that because we're so used to having running water, a warm house to go home to, you know, food in our tummies and a TV license. We're used to having all of that, and then we start taking it for granted. Whereas there's people in the world that are grateful to have a blanket to sleep under at night, you know, kind of thing.
Right.
So it's a powerful sort of way of thinking about the world and keeping it real, really, you know?
Right. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, I mean, you've talked about lots of different elements of your, I'm going to bring it back to you, lots of different elements of your life, and quite different, you know, from the sports to the acting to the entrepreneurship. Who do you think has been sort of like your greatest inspiration?
Kobe Bryant.
Okay. Oh, okay. Now, am I right in thinking that he passed away recently? He was in a crowd.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh. Unfortunate. But Kobe Bryant, it's hard for me to, okay. That was the guy that just showed me how to work hard, how to inspire other people, how to push the limit, you know, to you know, be on your game, A game, make sure you put all the work in, that put all your eggs in one basket and make more eggs to put in that basket, you know, stuff like that. He's that type of guy that really just like, man, like taught me how to work hard, like work hard, and you're going to get, you know, you can get the dreams you want and, you know, everything will come to you. So he was one of them inspirations. My next person was Cali Muscle. He's a fitness person. And he on YouTube, he's big on YouTube.
Okay.
Another person that inspired me was Louise Hay. I don't know if you know who that is.
Yes, I've heard of her. The Hay House Publishing.
I love her, man. I love what she's about, man. I love what she's about. And she passed over a few years ago, too. I like her. I like Michael Bernard Beckwith. I love him. I love Oprah, obviously.
Obviously, who doesn't love Oprah?
Acting wise, I love Will Smith. I love, you know, Denzel Washington, Matthew McConaughey. I have so many muses and people that inspire me. The list could go like, you know, I could go here forever. So, but who influenced me most was probably Kobe Bryant, Cali Muscle, Michael Bernard Beckwith, Louise Hay, Will Smith. My dad, my mom, you know, my girlfriend, her parents. Like, I take inspiration from, you know, many, many, many people. Even you. I'm going to find something that you inspired me about. I have so many. I feel like I'm missing them. Like, I don't want to miss them. But I have so many people that helped me on the way. I wouldn't be here without them, you know. So everybody that helped me on the way, they're an inspiration to me, too.
Yeah. Do you know, I it's interesting you say that because I think – you know, I mean, it's awesome that you've got the blue tick on Instagram and all that, and that you've got a good following, and you are in a position to influence. But I think anybody is in a position to be an influence. We're all influencers. When you walk down the high street and you smile at someone, you've maybe changed their day. You know, if your smile is contagious and they pick up on it and then they smile at someone else, you can, I think everybody, despite the amount of exposure you've got to the world, you have the ability to be an influencer in your own world, you know, and help people in your own world. You don't have to be, you know, you don't have to be a worldwide brand name, although of course that's lovely to aspire to. You just need to be kind and generous to the people around you, and that's sort of the way where to start, isn't it?
Yeah. Also, to even go even deeper, I'm inspired by Walmart, Target, Sam's Club, whatever. I don't, if you guys have that over there, what else? Like Walgreens, Rite Aid. I'm inspired by all of them because they sell so many products in their store. I said, okay, if they can sell so many products and, you know, inspire people to buy their products through them, I can do the same thing with my personal, you know, brand. And, oh, I forgot one person, Shaquille O'Neal. Forgot him. I'm so sorry, Shaq. I love him because he's the one guy that does that. You know, hey, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. And Master P, Lil Romeo, or Romeo Miller, all those people that, you know, sell multiple products, I'm inspired by that because if Walmart can go sell 1,000 things, why can't I sell 1,000 things and inspire people to a better life, you know? So, I have a big influence in Brazil. I have a lot of people that's helping me understand the language and teaching me the language right now through Instagram. Yeah, it's really big. I have a couple people that, you know, I want to shout out them and tell them, like, thank you. They really taught me a lot about the Brazilian. They teach me the Brazilian culture. I want to learn the right way. I don't want to just go over there and be like, hey, you know, I'm just, you know, from America. I think you guys should like me. I want them to really see that I'm similar to them and that I have a connection with them. And I have people that's teaching me the language. It's like things like that that happens on Instagram. Yeah, I've been learning Portuguese and I'm learning Espanol and I'm learning Italiano. So right now I'm just focusing on that as well. So, you know, I'm just blessed that people came to me on Instagram and said, hey, I teach you. And I teach them American. So it's like we win and win.
Yeah, that is cool. Well, sharing, isn't it? And spreading the love, really, you know, helping each other out. It's very cool. So what was the last book you read? Or I asked about the book, but I'm not a big reader myself. I like to learn through going to events or watching YouTube videos and that kind of thing. I listen to books more than actually reading. But is there, I know you're learning from other people, but is there a particular book that you're reading at the moment, or even what's your favorite book? What would be the book that you'd recommend to all aspiring individuals?
That's a good question, because I have so many good books that I read. Oh man, you put me on the spot with this one.
Sorry.
Okay. The book that I would recommend right now, just the way, like, on my heart right now, is Florence Scovel Shin, The Game of Life and How to Play It.
Okay. I've not heard of that.
Oh, you'll like it. It's just like, it just share with you the, you know, you gotta read it. I can't explain it, but it's an old book. Like I told you, I'm inspired by a lot of women as well. Like I told you, because my mom is she don't even know. She's really a genius. She just don't know. Like, she has to find her way, you know, through her own life. But I think she's starting to see it's a bigger world out there, even for herself. But her name, the author of the book is Florence Scovel Shin. And it's The Game of Life and How to Play It. And someone told me that book a long time ago. And when they first told me, I was like, okay, yeah, right. You know. You know, and it's one of those books that just teach you the law of prosperity and gratitude and love and how the game of life works, I guess. So you'll like it. It's a good book for people that just to get you a deeper gratitude of life.
Yeah, it's funny. Cool. I like positivity, as you know. It's interesting, though, you say that someone recommended it to you ages ago, because that's happened to me a few times where I'm like, not right now, not right now, right, not right now. And then it's almost like something that you're meant to read or look at almost follows you until you do, you know. So it will come, right. Comes back and gets you. That's very cool. So
because in life, you know, you get those signs and people sometimes give you information that you might need. And, you know, you have to have the gift of discernment or the gift of, like, okay, is that really right? You know, you have to check in with you. But life gives you feedback, you know, from other people and other things. So sometimes that person may be right. But sometimes they can be completely – I mean, you got to have that. It's like you got to understand, like, how that resonates with your life at this present moment. And, you know, that's what I would recommend, you know, to people and you. That if you just understand that the gift of discernment, or you develop that gift of discernment, you understand if something is good or if something is not good for you. You and life gives you that feedback.
Sure. Yeah. And now that you know you've come all this way, reflecting back, what would the advice be that you'd give young Diesel? You know, what would you say? Would you tell him anything differently, or, you know?
I don't have any regrets, if that's what you're saying. I don't have any of those. But what advice I would give myself is that just listen to what you want to do. Don't listen to what no one else tell you to do.
Right.
You listen to what, you know, what I want to do. Don't say, you know how some people are like, oh, you should be a firefighter. You should be a doctor. You should be a lawyer. I mean, those things are all good. I'm not saying none of that is good. Or you should do a 9-to-5, or you should do this, but nothing's wrong with that lifestyle, but I know what I want to do in my life.
Yeah, I think that's a really important thing to say. You know, my dad, he was quite keen for me to be a solicitor, but I'm an outdoors girl and I like, you know, I'm more of a heart-led person, and I don't, like I just said before, I don't even really like reading, so I would not make a good solicitor, you know. But that's, right. I think his thoughts around that were about, you know, the money, and we all need money. You know, it's one of those, I'm not even going to say a necessary evil, because money doesn't have to be evil. You know, it's one of those things we all need. But yeah, I think you, like you just said, you have to tune into what it is that inspires you and what drives you and what you enjoy doing and what's going to make you feel alive, you know?
Right, right. If you look at money evil, then that's how money looks at you. You have to look at money as prosperity and abundance and circulation, that you're, when you give it to somebody, you know, you hopefully that blesses them to do something in their life. Or when you pay your bill, you being thankful that the water's on, the heat is working, the lights are still on, or whatever the case may be. No, you got to look at money in a positive way, or the money will look back at you negatively. Sure. If you don't look at it.
Yeah, so true. Is there anything, before we wrap up, is there anything else that you kind of want to say while we're still chatting, or any final words?
All I would say is that, you know, tell to the followers and to listeners, to the people that support your movement, is to focus on, you know, themselves, to love yourself. So if you can't love yourself, you know, you can't love other people, or you can't, you know, bring that light to other people. If you're still mad about, you know, things that happened 100 years ago, when I say 100, I mean like 5, 10 years ago, whatever, a long time. So if you guys were listening, just, you know, love yourself and, you know, inspire people in your way, in your walk, your faith, and, you know, appreciate every day you have on this earth, and stay in the moment, stay in the present moment in life.
Very, very important stuff. Thank you so much. I have really enjoyed chatting to you and finding out more about what life has been like for you. So thank you for sharing that with us.
You're so welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'll just wrap up. If you like this video, then please do hit the like and subscribe button, and you'll get notifications when new videos are uploaded. You can find us on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. So come and join the conversation over there. And obviously on the podcast as well now. And yeah, please do share this story with anyone who you think may benefit from hearing it. Let's try and inspire more people and look after each other. So, and do get in touch if you know anybody who also wants to share their story, because I really do believe your story and your voice has the ability to help someone in their time of need. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll look forward to seeing you in another episode. Many thanks.